So, welcome everyone, and so to this event that Nini Kerr is going to be talking. She was Nini Fang when we started this process, but then she got married in the middle of it somehow. So makes some confusion. Anyway, welcome to you, Nini. But we're going to start off with, maybe I should just tell you a bit about our training. So we're now into the fourth year. We've got 45 students on the program. Our first lot should be completing this July, our first year, as it were. And then there's three more years stacked up behind them. So we thank you very much for your support and help that keeps us going. So I will now introduce Jeevika Shiv, who's in the second year of our program. She's a lawyer and also a social worker. I think I've got that right. And so I'll hand over to her to tell us something about her context in India and so forth. So over to you, Jeevika.
Thank you, Fahad, and thank you for organizing this space where we get to interact with everyone. So good morning, good evening, good afternoon, depending on where on the globe you're joining us from. I'm Jeevika, and I'm in the second year of a very interesting, invigorating, and challenging course of the group analysis course, which is located out of India. I just want to begin with a little bit of my background and context of why I'm here. So I'm a 36-year-old queer intercaste person. I belong half to a lower caste community in India, but also have the privileges of being half upper caste and being from a certain privileged class. And I say this because today's topic about differences and hostilities and collaborations is where I think a lot of our course and our cohort sort of comes together. I'm going to use this space to speak more from a lived experience and narrative reality of being a part of groups, systems and structures and what it does for the self. And before I start, I want to acknowledge some people I see in the room who've allowed space, who've created space for this to be, you know, innovated in different places. And I especially want to acknowledge Lev, who sort of held space for this sort of work across the globe and is one of the oldest people I know in the group analysis space, who encouraged me to come into such a program when I had not even heard of it. But I want to share some experiences as I begin. I think for me, a group identity has been very personal in terms of my caste background, my queer background, in terms of where I've lived, to navigate different spaces, but also in my work. I began working as a young person, and this was by chance because I navigated the state called the state of Gujarat, where I went for one vacation and I landed up getting caught in the crossfire of a riot. And some of my friends started getting, this was in 2002, who were caught in the riot. And I learned what it means to have different group identities, and I worked with riot survivors then. And I acknowledge them when I speak of what it means to work with groups. So, you know, these were survivors of communal violence that I then first helped with rescue and relief, but also worked with them from 2002 till almost 2019 directly in the state of Gujarat, both from being a young 18-year-old to going back till I was about 32, 33. And they access groups in a very different way, as groups of solidarity, as groups of, you know, safe space, but also groups, you know, to, as a site for also healing, but also to question for accountability. And I think that's where my location of coming into group analysis has been, to see, you know, how can we work with such groups with an idea of, you know, rooting what's our own lived experience and lived reality. And as we speak about hostilities today, I also speak about the spectrum from collaboration, solidarity, and hostility, which I learned from these groups. And one of those survivors I worked with has today won her case, and it wasn't alone. It was in a group, groups of lawyers, groups of activists, groups of, and her name is Bilkis Bano. She won her case, and again won a case where, you know, there was remission for all her accused. And so I look at in all these groups, we found solidarity. How do we also move beyond this to dialogues? How do we move the ambit of justice? How do we move the ambit to have these brave conversations, uncomfortable conversations, conversations around hate, which today, are a context in the India I come from. But also not only out there, but what do groups do to me? And what do they do to some of us who come into this space? And I think that's, I belong to a family which came from a lower caste identity, being a Bahujan as a what is called other backward caste. And a lot of masking happens in groups, right? To be able to survive across privileges, to survive across hostilities of caste, to survive and to be able to thrive, how do you create safer group spaces where we are unmasking not only the self, but also the intergenerational baggage of the self in a social reality? And I think that's where this course in India makes a lot of sense to me, because it looks at the self. And that's why my peers, many of whom are here, have also pushed the ambit to say it's not either the self or the structure, but also us in all its systems that come together. And, the identities and groups experiences around shame, of masking, of exclusions, would they also lead to more spaces around solidarity, which is what we've seen in the student movements that have been part of our country today. I've also been part of the farmers movement, which has worked as a group to talk about challenge in the state when exclusions happen. So can group analysis actually contribute to that space, allowing for leadership of the self, self-authority, and working with our own scripts, as Askrain said, to also working scripts of systems and the state. And I think that's where I come from. And I think you're wondering why I'm sharing this. I think for me, it is about looking at the question from an analytical framework. And also, we talk about all these words like decolonization. We talk about, anti-caste perspective. We talk about a feminist lens, and that's where I root myself. What would its lived reality look like in my context? What would it look like for, us sitting in this course to decide what is academic knowledge around group work, around working with small groups and large groups? Could I use it? And I think some of our classmates also explore those spaces when we work with groups of teachers working with different contexts, or we work with individuals and, and those who work with less power to build, to design, to collaborate. And I think it comes from my own need to understand what it means for those who are less powerful in social systems to take space, occupy space, and also build, not only come into inclusions, but also lead, co-create. And I think that's the spirit with which group analysis comes here. Of course, it doesn't come without its contradictions of who do we give space to, do we allow Indian institutions to lead? What is Indian? Who is Indian in the many Indians that we come to here? Can there be true collaboration between, spaces which are internationally led from the global north and institutions which come from the global south, but also being aware that we have our own hierarchies and power relations and all of that. So I think today I'm here to begin this by asking some questions of, when the state is not providing ground to do this, where else can we actually open up spaces, groups which talk about a safe space for individuals within the group and groups within structures to be able to build further? How do we not negate? How do we also look at learning from an intersectional lens around all of this? And how do we work with our own families and communities, with our own built realities of this space? And I also want to stress the importance of rooting it in today's context. I come from an India where there's a lot of conflict, a lot of differences, and not too many collaborations. So are we going to be building across this vulnerability, as, Teresa asked, and all of you, some of you may know Teresa from the world of group and large group analysis. She said, how do we sit with the hate, but also how do we sift with the difference? And not only sit with it, but also build with it, listen to it, and also collaborate across it. And I think that's critical for us in the Indian context. One of the experiences of group analysis also makes me think about the situation in Manipur, which is a state in India where there's been differences and violence on an indigenous community by the majority community, which I belong to in its identity. And I wonder what we as group analysts could contribute to that space, which has been a space of continuing violence and that sort of is just a symbol of the larger differences we're seeing and the larger hostilities, which you will perhaps, Nini, unpack for us, and how do we dialogue across those. But there's potential to look at groups in that space, and also to look at our own roles as a majority, as people of privilege within our own context, to be able to do this work. And I think none of it can happen without looking at the small groups, which have been a real big learning to look at, you know, how the personal is political in that space, but also how do you build from the small to the large at the same time and not get stuck in one space, I think for me. And I think I'd go back to saying that some of this learning is really crucial in our context, to allow for a psychodynamic process of groups, to analyze systems, to analyze conflict, to be able to really work from within instead of the external. And I also have an appeal. The strength is to innovate and build from those who've had reality. So each group looks different. But I think today what we're appealing to you is also to allow for resourcing that difference, to collaborating, to build that difference, and also listen to my peers here who are now building from that difference. And as they graduate, creating spaces to truly decolonize, to truly be able to, you know, bring in that context, and also a different academic river, which is rooted in our own many Indianisms and many global South narratives that we have across this space. Thank you so much for being here today. And I really hope that you continue to contribute to this space that allows some of us who may not have the sort of means to study in places of privilege to be here. I just want to say that this is the first place that I've been in a non-public space. Not public university. As I end, I just wanted to leave you with this thought. And we've been in public universities, which sort of some of us that fund and allow us to build like this, without the burden of, you know, our financial realities. And but yet there are many of us who are not as privileged to be able to afford such spaces. And so in our collaborations and solidarities, resourcing such things would be of great help. And I encourage you to also spread the word about that.
Thank you so much, Jeevika. You can see that we learn as much from our students as we teach. So I now hand across to Nini. I just to say for the people who weren't at the start that I am recording the first part onto the discussion. So you've read, I won't to repeat what you've already read about Nini, but I came across Nini and her work a year ago and was really, I learned a lot about Fairbairn through her, so which is why we've invited her. So over to you.
Thank you. Thanks, Farad. And it's a pleasure to be here with all of you and to see so many familiar and new faces as well. And as Farad said, I am passionate about Fairbairn. So it's a pleasure to be invited to share what I know about Fairbairn, but to also have that tempered by a certain sense of democracy, because I know Farad's work and I know him a bit as well. And I know the Farad's passion is always about how to turn a group into a thinking collective. So that takes a lot of coming together in order to think, and it takes a lot of challenging the linear notion of the crowd as the object to be spoken at. So in order to do so and see how we get on together, see where we go, I want to divide my presentation in two parts, where the first part is where I want to speak a bit about Fairbairn's theoretical foundations and my own takes of its psychosocial implications and its potential, and focusing on the concept that I draw on and use in my own work. And the point of this is that we want to actually introduce Fairbairn's ideas to people in a way that allows more intimate grappling with his work, that invites you into the conversation to think with us and to speak with us, because we're not really interested in that kind of notion of the speaker and the audience kind of hierarchy. And so it's kind of a little step to challenge that. Then the second part is where I will be speaking about my recently published work entitled Culture as the Bad Object, which is published in Psychoanalysis, Culture and Society. And to kind of share with you how I use Fairbairn's work to analyze and look into my own racist feelings towards the racialized other. And that is quite a challenging, effective ride for myself. So I want to allow myself to project certain benignness onto this collective in order to allow myself to be transparent and honorable and vulnerable. So bear with me as I do that. So we begin with Fairbairn and his key concept. I'm going to use a couple of slides just to kind of give people a certain sense of what his work is about and why I think it really kind of has a lot of psychosocial potential in order to help us understand the interface between the personal, the collective, the cultural, and the political. So Farad has kindly agreed to be my psychic today to put on the slide. Thank you, Farah. So I was doing a bit of collaging and a bit of artwork to help me kind of purge some of the nasty psychoaffective affect. So I will be talking about hostile environments as a nasty political condition with a lot of punitive conditionality against the racialized other. But I want to think about that, particularly from Fairbairn's idea. So next slide. Thanks, Farad. So a bit about the chat. So Fairbairn, and because this is such a diverse crowd and people are from different parts of the world, and so a bit of kind of introduction, I think will be quite helpful for us to delve into his work and why he came to theorize human psyche in his unique way. And what's the context around it? So just a bit about it. So W.R.D. Fairbairn, and he is commonly known as Ronald Fairbairn, and he's born and bred Scot. He went to University of Edinburgh, where I did my PhD as well. And he spent his life working in the geographically remote position of Edinburgh, away from the central hub of the psychoanalytic circle back then in London. Now I'm mentioning these because this geographical isolation was critical, that it enabled him to actually develop something that is radically different from the orthodox instinct theory that Freud and Klein formulated and endorsed, and to form his own very unique object relations theory that we come to see as the relational or the Fairbairnian ways of thinking about the human psyche. Let's be honest as well that every single group will have its own politics. And of course, that applies to the psychoanalytic circle and then and now. So because of his work and how he radically challenged the Freudian orthodox, he was quite marginalized. He was quite isolated. And his book, Psychoanalytic Studies of the Personality, was reviewed not in a favorable light by the dominant players in the field back then, such as Masoud Khan and Winnicott, who we know are not only active, but whose work is much more endorsed. So you have to think about having his work reviewed not in a positive light by key players in the field was quite a blow for Fairbairn, and that really also reinforced his own sense of isolation and alienation from the psychoanalytic circle then, and made him less willing to hop on to the Flying Scotsman, the train, and to be on a 12-hour journey to get to London. But in any case, that alienation and that isolation allowed him the critical distance to remain engaged with his relational thinking that contradicted the orthodox. However, of course, it has rippling effect that even now, if you are presenting something on Fairbairn, you know, it tends to be quite less known, less engaged with, and less cited. So that alienation continued to reverberate until today. So that's a bit about Fairbairn. What does he have to say? Next slide. Oh, right, yes, okay. So as I said, he lived in Edinburgh and he practiced, worked, and conducted his clinical engagement in Edinburgh. It was such a fangirl moment for me when I was doing my doctoral degree, and I encounter this book in the library, which is an original copy of the Psychoanalytic Studies of the Personality, which was donated and signed by Fairbairn himself to the university. So that encounter was quite a relational moment where I was kind of figuring out my own sense of alienation and my own experiences. So it was certainly very nice to ascertain his presence as a real person. So theoretical departure, this is kind of like the why Fairbairn bit. So just a little bit about why his work continues to be significant for the way we are thinking about the human psyche in relation to the social world, social political context. So Fairbairn initially took his theoretical departure from Melanie Klein. And we know that Melanie Klein has this theory about positions such as the paranoid, schizoid position and the depressive position and the internalized object. So they really had a massive impression on Fairbairn, and Fairbairn took Melanie Klein's ideas to think about how we create internal representations of the outside world. However, he didn't stop there. Even though he originally inherited Kleinian thinking, that influences gradually became faint as there's irreconcilable differences in the way they think about and conceptualize the nature of aggression. So where Klein thought about aggression as linked to the innate kind of instinct of the death instinct, Fairbairn actually thought about aggression as more defensive rather than reactive in nature. And this is crucial because I think it really helps us think about what Jeevika has mentioned early on about political violence and what it means to resist. So we go on to that in a bit. So third point here is that, so Fairbairn's thinking such as object seeking and object relatedness, as well as the endopsychic structure, they tend to get reduced into some kind of theoretical idioms, and there isn't sufficient in-depth or nuanced engagement with the kind of contemporary reading. So my work wants to kind of really speak back to Fairbairn and using Fairbairn's thinking as a unique line of psychosocial inquiry to think about psyche as a meeting place of the personal, community, and the social political. and to contest the so-called notion of the individual psyche, to show how the psyche is not opaque, but how it's always reproducing and recreating what goes on outside. Through doing so, it also allows us to disrupt the more kind of traditional, conventional, or orthodox notions of the symptoms that has been overtly familiarized or domesticated as directly originated within the familial context, but to see symptoms as an embodiment of complex political conditions and struggles of individuals and communities. So next slide.
Sorry.
So object relatedness, and I'm pretty sure that people here are kind of familiar with these, right? Object seeking, object relatedness, they are kind of the household sorts of common usage. But I think Fairbairn really is telling us something quite different that continues to kind of challenge the way we think about our practice, continue to challenge the way we think about what makes a person ill, and also how health is maintained and at whose cost. So for Fairbairn, we are born straight into relationships. We are born straight into a network of social relations or interlocking networks of social relations in the political context from birth. So different from Melanie Klein, whose idea is more, you might call, idealist, in the sense that Melanie Klein believes that our internal world is a recreation of the external world. However, a lot of that recreation is distorted by the functions of fantasizing. So that's subject to the unconscious process of fantasizing how others are, fantasizing the intentions of others. And through such a process, through the process of fantasizing, we also distort other people into more dramatic and distorted forms of object relations within us. So more idealist in a sense of how the external world exists only in so far as we fantasize them into being. For Fairbairn, he disagrees. He thinks in a more realist way, or what Graham Clark would call the critical realist way, that the content, what is inside the so-called psyche, is actually a realistic recreation of what goes on outside. So our actual experiences of what goes on outside and our interactions with what goes on outside is what populate, is what becomes internalized into our psyche, our internal world. So that connection is a lot more direct, is a lot more reflective of the kind of the process through which we are engaged by the social relations. So the child constructs the internal world. We create the internal world in ways that mirror and reduplicate the external reality. But of course, through this reconstruction and reduplication, other people, the kind of separate subjectivities of others, also become fragmented, because the truth is we can never fully grasp the true intentions of other people and what they mean and what has been said. So there's always an element of imagination. And you can think about Lacan's idea of the imaginary. We are always experiencing something, and we are always experiencing something because that process is subject to the process of interpretation. However, Fairbairn believes in the actual social relationships. We experience something, we recreate something within us. So whilst the instinct theory proposed by Freud really focuses on the gratifications of desires, Fairbairn proposed instead that it is the experience of the relationship that is the basic innate need from birth, so that all human struggles are relational struggles. Now, to make this kind of easier to grapple with and to think about, for those of you who are parents, right, you might recall incidents where your child is crying and kicking and asking for a toy to be purchased for them, right? So in the instinct theory level, the theorization here will be that it is the toy that the child wants. It is the gratification of wanting and needing that need to be satisfied. Okay? For Fairbairn, who thinks that it is not the instinct, it is not about the wanting and needing. Rather, it is the object to whom we direct our wanting and desire. So it's not the toy, but the relational experience of having my father buying me a toy in a way that shows me that he loves me and he cares for me. So it is the relational experience of being responded to that is what Fairbairn sees as the innate need and desire. So we seek relationships and a sense of relatedness. And this is the core meaning of object seeking. Because object seeking is not an act, and it is not propelled by the love and hate instinct alone, but it is propelled by our need to construct relational meanings through which we come to ground and anchor ourselves in social relations, in the sense of who am I in relation to you, not what I want from you, what I need from you, but who am I in relation to you? And that response is crucial for our identity, for our sense of belonging. And as Lynn, who is here, Lynn's idea of mutual implication, it is through constructing and creating these relational meanings of who am I in relation to a particular group? Who am I in relation to a particular someone? Who am I in relation to a particular state? All these enable us to implicate in social relations that is crucial for us to respond to the wider existential questions about identity. So, also very important here to say that Fairbairn is not romanticizing relationship. He's not saying that we seek relationship, you know, in a always in a benign way, but relationships are sought out to play out the old trauma and the internalized power dynamics from the past. So you can think about, for example, the colonial object relations where the colonizer or people who occupy the subjectivity of the whiners can seek out the racialized, minoritized others to put them in the place and to relate to them in a way that demands obedience, that demands conformity, that demands submissiveness, right? So are seeking object in a way to play out the familiar social relations. Okay. And my work later on will kind of grapple with this a little bit more to think about how we recreate the internal world in a way to kind of influence what goes on outside and how we relate to others.
Next slide.
Thank you. So, In a nutshell, subjectivity is formed through social relations that one experiences, desires, and creates. And Fairbairn's original thinking influenced the later paradigm shift that we have come to know as the relational turn, which sees the unconscious processes as occurred in response to the actual relational experiences in a real world, in a real-time social political reality. Through these, we also come to infer how Fairbairn does not believe in the individual psyche, but the individual psyche, or the so-called individual psyche, is already saturated, already reproducing the social political context and conditions outside. Fairbairn says, what is meant by pleasure seeking in the classic theory is really relief of libidinal tension. But my point is that such tension is inherently the tension of object seeking need. The real libidinal aim, so libidinal in Fairbairn's thinking, refers to what we want, what we need, and the innate desiring and wanting. So what he's saying is that what we really want is the establishment of satisfactory relationships with object. And it is object that constitute the true libidinal goals. I'm highlighting this particular line because satisfactory or unsatisfactory feature a lot in Fairbairn's work. And it also gets misinterpreted quite a bit. But what Fairbairn really means by satisfactory is the sense of responsiveness to experience the social others as capable, as caring enough to respond to us, that when I'm in distress, when I'm sad, when I'm upset, when I fall, I cry, and I experience the social others, my carer, the significant others, to be caring enough to respond to me, to attend to me. And the effort does not need to be perfect. And of course, you'll be thinking about Winnicott's idea of the good enough mothering, in the sense of how it is not the cleverness of the mother. It is not the mother's perfect adaptation to the baby's cries or needs, but rather it is that being able to respond to the baby in distress, that is what the child is seeking. It's what makes it a satisfactory relationship. So kind of thinking about Fairbairn and Winnicott, you think about how there's actually quite a fair bit of similarities in the way they think about what we want and what we need as human beings. But also, ironically, you need to think about how, because of the politics back then, he did not really get that level of understanding and endorsement from Winnicott, which Fairbairn himself has expressed significant disappointments about. It was a massive blow for him. So in Fairbairn's object relations thinking, we are not naturally aggressive, that there's no human baby that is born aggressive, that is born ready to bite, as proposed by the instinct theory. But we become angry because we were first frustrated. We first experience our need and our desire to be responded to thwarted. Aggression or aggressiveness or anger came as a way to somehow defend against the affect that's even more unbearable and even more overwhelming, which is shame. The shame that when I'm distressed, no one came near. The shame that I love you, but you do not love me back. The shame that I respect you so much, but you do not reciprocate with my desiring you, with my wanting you, wanting our closeness, wanting to get closer, wanting that intimacy, wanting relationality. Is there anything more shameful than that? and how we experience shame as a very powerful experience of human despair. So for Winnicott, we are angry because anger somehow is a more bearable affect. So we become angry in order to cut us off from the awareness of shame. So as Farad has mentioned just now that Fang was my original surname and I got married recently. And we know Fang in English also means sharp teeth. So I used to bite a lot. But since I got married, I think I bite a lot less now. So I, yes, okay. So we're coming to the end of the introductory bit of Fairbairn's idea, and I cannot wait to kind of share with you how I bring all of this together in thinking about the hostility outside. So just bear with me for a couple more slides. So as we said, in Fairbairn's thinking, the primary need in terms of what we want, what we really want, is the establishment of satisfactory relationships with object. So the unsatisfactory is in the sense of rejecting, unresponsive, indifferent, hostile, and rejecting others. And this leads to the psychological defense of splitting and repression of these experiences as the bad object. And of course, here we can see his Kleinian inheritances here about how splitting and repression and internalization always go hand in hand. So essentially for Fairbairn, the bad object are repressed because they are too disruptive and threatening to the ongoing relationship. That it's too overwhelming for us to bear those experiences of being deprived, unresponded to, or rejected within our conscious awareness. So we repress them. Well, we split them into good and bad, bearable and unbearable, and then we repress what feels too overwhelming and too unbearable. Now, I really, really need to emphasize this bit because originally, Fairbairn in his 1943 paper theorized that it was only the bad unsatisfying object that became internalized and repressed. Later on, in his later work, he theorized that it is not just the bad object. Okay, it is not just the others, the unsatisfying, the rejecting others that we have to actually repress and internalize. But it is also the part of us that respond to, that engage with this bad object, that also become split and internalized. We can go to the next slide. So this has significant psychosocial potential here, because what he's actually challenging is the linear notion of the sovereign subject, the holistic idea of the selfhood. But rather, when we actually split the external others into good and bad, and in Fairbairn's idea, we take upon the burden of the badness into the self. So we take upon the badness of them inside us in order to see others as good. And he doesn't stop there. He went on to say that it also then creates an internal division within the self where we also become split off. That the part of us that actually engage, bond with, respond to.
The tape that was just released, it talked to
this. Okay. and become entangled with those bad objects, also become repressed. I will definitely go on to say a bit more about that in a bit. So this is Fairbairn's idea of the endopsychic structure. So if we just come to that diagram. Okay, so this is Fairbairn's original diagram with my own kind of node here. So you can see the dotted line here, and the dotted line is the boundary in a more kind of rudimentary way of seeing it. The more kind of basic way of seeing it is the kind of the border of the consciousness and the unconsciousness, and what underneath is the unconsciousness. So you can see how we are forever idealizing others who are potentially disappointing and rejecting. So through this process of idealizing others and making good their badness, we take upon the burden of the badness. So beneath the dotted line, you see how there are two bad objects which we internalize from the outside world. The rejecting and attacking object. The exciting, disappointing object. Now, to make this more kind of relatable and accessible, let's focus on the left side of the diagram first. So the rejecting, attacking object. So you can think about this as capturing a record of the relational experiences where we feel profoundly rejected and attacked. And of course, that experience is quite painful to bear in conscious awareness. So repress that. And that's not all we do. So for Fairbairn, in order to continue to solidify the sovereign of the rejecting, attacking object, us as the selves also split. There's a part of us that actually bonds with the rejecting object, which he called the internal saboteur. And he later changed that into the anti-libidinal ego. So the anti-libidinal ego is the part of the self who actually agrees with the attacking power, the rejecting narrative of the rejecting object. He agrees with it, and he sees the rejecting, attacking object as the absolute boss, absolute sovereign. Okay? We can think about how that's the part of us that attacks ourselves when we are being attacked. You're not good enough. You're terrible at this job. No wonder other people don't like you. No wonder you're rejected. You're so clumsy. You're so inadequate. No wonder you're rejected. So this is what in the psychotherapeutic idiom, we call the second arrow. So the first arrow is where you're actually being, you know, you're going through something pretty horrible. You're critiqued, you're criticized, you're attacked. And that's not enough. You go home to kick yourself. You critique yourself, you attack yourself, you berate yourself, right? Can we now all relate to that? So for Fairbairn, that is the voice and the working of the anti-libidinal ego. On the other side, on the right side of the diagram, you also have the exciting, disappointing object. So this is the part of the object who, in Fairbairn's word, it's incredibly powerful in tantalizing us. It's a bit of a seductress. It arouses a powerful longing in us. And yet, whatever it arouses in us, whatever it makes us desire, it does not fulfill. It does not grant. It does not satisfy. Right? So you can think about Franz Fanon's black skin, a white mask, in terms of desiring to become white, desiring to become something, yes, also, yet also knowing that he can never be white. Okay, so wanting to be something, but you cannot be, or you are prevented from being able to be that something which you desire to be. And the part of us that allies with the exciting, disappointing object is the vulnerable self. So the libidinal ego is the part of us who wait, but who wait in vain, who wait in a perpetual state of helplessness, of knowing that no one will respond to your distress, no one will respond to your longing, no one will respond to your cries. And yet she waits and waits and waits. She's vulnerable and she waits in vain. futility. You can see how the arrows here, which indicate aggression. This is also the part of us that is attacked by multiple sources. It's attacked by the rejecting, attacking object inside of us, as well as attacking by the anti-libidinal ego inside of us. So we can see the kind of power dynamics here. WOC means woman of color. So the part of the kind of the self that longs to be accepted, and yet that acceptance just doesn't come or doesn't come easy. So this is kind of like maybe a crash course of Fairbairn's theory and the psychosocial potential. Now I want to go on to share my work to hopefully integrate some of these and my own reflections together. So thank you, Farad. If we can just close that. Thanks. So I don't know about you, but I know that some people are a lot more visual. I know I'm a visual person. So when I listen to people, you know, talk and talk and talk a long time, I tend to feel like I can drift away a little bit. So I wonder if I can share my screen so you can see my work and also listen to my voice rather than just sort of rely on the audio clue completely. So let's see if we can do that. Okay. Can I just check whether you can see my my writing or not?
Yes, yep.
Oh, fabulous. Okay, great. So my work is entitled Culture as the Bad Object, and having thought about Fairbairn's work together with you, I hope you can see what exactly I'm trying to problematize here. So without further ado, let's just delve into the paper. Okay. My partner and I were on a bus from Edinburgh on the way to the borders. A few stops further down the journey, a group of East Asian people got on. This should not have bothered me, but it did. My account will reveal how the internal and external world each permeate and produce the other, which make us feel and act in ways that defy our character and best intentions. The theoretical discussion that follows attempts to use my experience of internalized racism as a focus of reflexive inquiry, adapting Fairbairn's original object relations theory psychosocially. I hope the audience will bear with me, as doing so requires me to look into how the historically constituted social contract has taken root in me, and as my vignette will reveal, can produce racist feelings when these implicit terms and conditions of how one should be are challenged. The implicit social contract that governs how one should be and how one should conduct oneself in social relations, according to Charles Mills, is underwritten by the racial contract in such a way that rights, duties, and freedoms are frequently allocated on a racially differentiated basis. The racial contract, as I reveal in the accounts below, powerfully shapes my everyday interactions with white and non-white others. In this examination, I cast light on the internal crisis when feelings betray identity, a crisis which is hard to confront without a backlash of feelings of hypocrisy and fraudulence against oneself. As I have argued alongside many other scholars, such auto-ethnographic explorations are essential for expanding psychoanalysis beyond its conventional scope of intra-psychic examinations towards a more critical psychosocial praxis that meaningfully explores the implications of sociality and historicity on the psychic processes. Back to the bus. In the rear of the upper deck of the bus, we sat back, taking in the countryside breeze that slipped in from the window. The cool air calmed the queasiness in me, amplified by the anticipation of another hour of travel ahead. The group of people who had just boarded walked down towards us, past us. Judging by the logo on his hoodie, this appeared to be an overseas student accompanied by his family. Perhaps seizing the opportunity to do some sightseeing before university started. They set themselves down in the last row, right behind us. Soon, loud chatters were unleashed amongst themselves, their sandwich wrappers crackling. Uttered with a racing cadence and excitement, their voices were distinct like a light football channel on a radio. The sense of unease intensified in me. I straightened up. I recognized who these voices belonged to, by which I mean where they came from. Other passengers in the front rows began to turn their heads around to look at us with expressions that indicated annoyance. A thought crept up in me. From their vantage point, it must have looked like we were all part of the same group. A sense of shame washed over me at the suspicion that I had been identified as one of them, the guilty party who wouldn't stop shooting up squirrels of clink-clank that wrecked the otherwise peaceful and quiet ambiance all of us had managed to enjoy till now. A coiled charge of anger surged in me at their obliviousness to the looks other passengers were casting towards them, which I felt I was also on the receiving end of. Worse even, in my head, I feel somehow responsible to get the group to quiet down so we would not be seen as such a nuisance. A gentle tap on my wrist from my partner, who's white British, reminded me that the internal crisis was still attached to a living body. I realized that this powerful mixture of anger and shame had melted into a strange ache in my chest where my hand was now laying on. He whispered to me, "Relax, not long to go now, and try to focus on the scenery outside." This was hard. What I was trying to get out of, namely this internal crisis, could not find a merciful moment or relief from the views of the landscape outside, the heather moors and rolling green hills of the Scottish countryside outside the window. For this crisis was a crisis of identity, of a clash, of seeing myself as anti-racist, anti-oppressive, someone who had dedicated effort to the decolonial project, yet right at that moment being so caught up in a kind of horror, a kind of hate that is racially driven. Yet these racist feelings of contempt and aggression as directed outward towards the loud group of passengers had nowhere to go but ended up ricocheted against a portion of the self that extended into a sweeping view of a wasteland. A ruin with no flow of time, no horizon, a ruin that is the everlasting, horrifying presence of the past. Here, love and compassion towards difference, especially within the self, are as exhausted as the political rhetoric that marks you out as unbelonging and asks you to return to your home, to your place of origin. Caught up in the middle of an inner horror, an impulse brimmed with simple glory of a promise that the only way out of this overbearing, affective cocktail of anger and shame would be to move to the other side. This would declare once and for all that I was not one of them. Shame, however, refocused my evaluation on the simplest measure of appearance. that I cannot share my yellow skin, no matter where I relocate? What if being the only yellow person on the white side isolates me on the receiving end of further contemptuous looks? These fears held me immobile. In this moment, the derogatory cliché of the rowdy and unruly Chinese tourist so often evoked in media portrayals loomed large. Feeling isolated, I was alarmed by the prospect that to get up and move away from them, my fellow yellow people, now will send a clear message of betrayal that I, one who looked just like them, had kowtowed to the Western production of these harmful stereotypes. What would they think of me and say about me that I could not help understand in my own mother tongue? Much of these agonies were self-inflicted, of course, that a fact that could be thought about without being comprehended at that time. No one was accusing me of anything apart from my own hyper self-consciousness of my proximity to them on the grounds of my Chinese-like appearance and my capacity to understand and to speak the language that was now a source of offense. My need to dissociate in waiting for this agony to pass me over was punctured by the echoes of the loud sighs from the wide side of the bus, as though they were gasping for a last breath of fresh air. I heard them as exaggerated war cries that, in my head, it was as though the white passengers at the front were together holding the line against the rattling bombardment of a foreign kind, pushing their way against a tranquil and orderly world of common sense. Upon arrival, I spluttered to my partner with fervor. You see, bizarrely in a Chinese accent more strongly uttered than ever. This is why people here don't like Chinese people. Seemingly taken aback, he said, you are sounding quite racist just now, you know. They weren't that bad. Thinking all along that I was just feeling a bit queasy on the bus and did not even think much of the Chinese tourists that had been my imagined nemesis. What was going on? What was going on in me that produced such an overbearing experience with my fellow racialized others? And how could Fairbairn help me think through this? And most importantly, how may doing so open up a new framework for thinking psychosocially? In the ensuing discussion, I will explore the social political landscape outside, focusing especially on UK's hostile environment and its underlying mechanism that functions as a racial contract, which subject non-white individuals to oppressive conditions by reinstating the de facto form of ethno-nationalism, which perpetuates white supremacy.
Nini, to interrupt. Take another 10 to 15 minutes because we're after 3 already.
Okay, thank you. Yep. You can see how I have quite a lot to share with you about this work.
Yeah.
So the prevailing atmosphere of hostility and cruelty saturating the UK's hostile environment culture embodies the concept of the bad object in Fairbairn theory. On one hand, I recognize my dependence on the Home Office to fulfill my relational needs by granting me the leave to remain in this country. On the other hand, I was confronted with its intensely militarized hostility, which tended to view non-white immigrants as disposable, mere statistics to be reduced. No doubt, my presence here and the desire to remain here are intertwined with the cultural allure with the enticing facet of British life. Nevertheless, it is worth noting that this aspect had primarily been shaped by white colonial ideals, which have long portrayed racial others and individuals from foreign states as inherently inferior. As articulated by Du Bois, everything great, good, efficient, fair, and honorable is white. Everything mean, bad, blundering, cheating, and dishonorable is yellow, brown, and black. Whiners, an alluring yet perpetually distant mirage that captivates the psyche, sparks a yearning for identification with it. It beckons as an ever-elusive ego ideal, forever slipping beyond the self's reach. The external racial dynamics insidiously internalize themselves within the endopsychic structure, shaping one's interactions with others, and more significantly, how one relates to aspects of the self. Going back to the bus, the Western gaze, which I perceive to bestow so clearly a disapproval of the rude and rowdy Chinese, alerted me to the invisible surveillance of social contract that never rests. It simultaneously alerts to me a cultural distinction between what is considered good versus bad, desirable versus improper. My self-consciousness of my proximity to them turn itself into a fountain of inferiority, which, as noted by Freud, ooze out of the experience of shame when one fails short of the standard of the ego ideal of whiners. My dependence on the home office as an immigrant and the shame I feel for not living up to its definition of a good immigrant were both simultaneously triggered, prompting me to a defensive actions, to quite literally side with the white who hold power over the non-white, to judge and reject those who it perceives to be undeserving, according to its own propriety meter that says, this is how you should behave and this is not. Aligning myself with whiners as an enticing object stirs within me a promise of a better world where a higher order of civility appears to reside. However, the very essence of that captures me and excites me is a standard I can never fulfill. While I may be culturally influenced by the essence which defines Britishness, I am not and can never truly be white. I'm coming to the finale of my paper. Striving for validation within the cultural archetype of whiners can be parallel to a precarious pact with the devil. The allure of whiners, the very ideal one aspires to embody for social acceptance, inevitably confronts individuals with its contemptuous counterpart, the racist spectator who reject all those who are not white. This is the intricate psychological interplay that Fairbairn terms as the moral defense. Moral defense unfolds as a space where the exciting object and the rejecting object are reunited, ensnaring the individual within a bewildering, anguish-inducing enigma characterized by incessant self-reproach. Translated into the language of Freudian theory, the pursuit of the ego ideal inherently exposes the individual to the unrelenting judgment of the disapproving superego. Moral defense can be contemplated as a site in which the diabolical tantalizer, as poignantly phrased by James Grosstein, takes on tangible form. It is a space where the origins of our allure morph into instruments of torment, and the very elements that torment us weave an enticing web that catches within its seductive embrace. While appealing to the whiners grants me a fleeting sense of superiority and righteousness, these are illusory in the context of my perpetual racial otherness. This identification with whiners creates an internal division within me that, on one hand, there is the anti-libidinal ego who seeks identification with white surveillance and forges a bond with it to side with what feels powerful and shield against any vulnerability stemming from racial otherness. They form, to quote Ogden, a bond or resentment that perpetuate the object relations between the tormentor and the aggrieved. On the other hand, there is the libidinal ego who helplessly longs for acceptance and approval by the exciting object of the colonial ideal as embodied by the whiners, despite being acutely aware that deep down such acceptance will never truly materialize. Within this dynamic, the libidinal ego, which contains the vulnerable, yearning part of the self, becomes the target of relentless attacks from the anti-libidinal ego, which holds disdain for any human flaws of neediness and dependence. The anti-libidinal ego rejects and humiliates the libidinal ego for longing for love from the exciting object. You never learn your lesson. You get kicked in the face and drag yourself to your feet as if nothing has happened, only to get kicked and knocked down again. You can perhaps now see my comment that this is why people here don't like Chinese people, reveals much of the underlying psychodynamics of the bond of contempt in action. It orchestrates a sinister alliance between the rejecting object and the anti-libidinal ego, launching relentless attacks on the libidinal ego who yearns for acceptance, belonging, and approval. These contemptuous assaults give rise to an overwhelming sense of a self that is shrouded in inadequacy and undesirability, not only within oneself, but projected onto those perceived as similar. Quoting Ian Satie, whose relational thinking influenced Fairbairn, we begin to grasp the truth that the indulgences we are forced to renounce in oneself, we will certainly not permit to other people. What we are unable to love and accept within ourselves, we are incapable of loving and accepting when we come across them in others. Viewed through this lens, the comment paradoxically becomes an expression of the internalized oppressor within me, self-condemning as the oppressed. Now you see why people here don't like you. When the object relations mirror social relations, hostility trumps empathy. The anti-libidinal ego persists in its indifference towards the torment of racial suffering, relegating it to the status of mere self-pity. It perceives vulnerability as weakness, contempt and rejection as power. It insists that my shortcomings are to blame, urging me to believe that the only way to rise above my struggle is to align myself with the powerful and to denounce the weak, to join those who reject, not those who are deemed rejectable. It thrives on a toxic ideology of blame and condemnation embodied by the hostile environment as the rejecting object, perpetuating a destructive cycle of oppression and discrimination that sustains it. For Fairbairn, we are born into relationships and our inner world is populated by social relations. The psyche is formed through our relationships with objects. It is the relationships we have with these objects rather than the objects themselves that hold significance. The endopsychic structure, serving as our guiding relational schema, preserves our distinct affective valence of how we engage with others and invest ourselves emotionally in our relationships with them. Knowingly or unknowingly, we are possessed by the influences of the bad object, as if by evil spirit, which compel us to act in surprising ways. Extending this view psychosocially, our relationality becomes intricately entangled with the unfolding social and political context that surrounds us. As I have illustrated above, they become part of us. What goes on outside becomes recreated so that what divides a society divides the self. We can never exist apart from our social relationships, and this recognition requires us to investigate the impact of the culture which cultivates and sustains particular relational conditions for how to exist, how to present oneself, and how to engage with others, especially across diverse identities and backgrounds. applying Fairbairn theory to explore the culture of hostile environment as the bad object, we come to understand how the oppressed can become the oppressor, that which we cannot bear within ourselves become our most formidable nemesis in the external world.
तू ये माने के न माने लोग मानेंगे जरूर ये मेरा दीवाना
जी